Hey guys, as you know, I'm shorting bonds, and I really like this trade very, very much. I'm now at minus 12% exposure. Bonds have been going down. I started shorting around 162, I think. Yeah, around 160 mostly, so it's down a little bit. The TLT fund, that's what I invest in. But I'm selling. Here you have the TLT fund. And you can see here that interest rates went down to, this is 0.9% right now. It went up a bit. Huh? We're now at 0.9% that the 10-year treasury is yielding in interest, 0.9%. But we went down to 0.5% during the Corona crisis a couple months back, and we come from 1.8%. It was still yielding at the start of the year, and these are historical low yields, 0.5%, huh? 0.5%. Let's see, 0.5%. Here, 0.5% on March, and that's crazy, huh? 0.5%. We were at 3% here and at 2% here, and during the financial crisis of 2008, for example, we were at here. Oh, it's not showing here, but basically, if TLT stays flat, it's the same interest rate, huh? So the interest rate was still here. If you look up here, also 3. Wait, 3.4 here. And this is 3.4. So about 3%. It's been for a long time, dropping to basically 2% here. Back to 3, back to 2. But we're now at 0.5%. So in the grand scheme of things, it's absolutely insane. We come from 15%. We didn't see 0.5% when money was still more sound here in the 40s during the World War. The bottom was actually also 2% and not lower. So it's the first time in 2020 that we go below 2%. And not a little bit, a lot, to 0.5%. So that's the total collapse. And that might actually likely be the bottom that we just saw in this very long-term cycle that takes 40 years. 1980 was the peak, 2020 is the bottom. 40 years of declining interest rates. Before that, we had from 1940 to 1980, 40 years of rising interest rates. Before that, we had a shorter cycle. 1940, 2020, so that's 1920, so 20 years of rise, dropping interest rates, and before that, I don't know where the bottom was. But very long cycles that take 20 to 40 years, so you could say it's maybe 30 years on average. Only I have a chart going back to 1900 here, I don't have anything more, but money has changed, and what you can see clearly also is that, yeah, the Fed does not control interest rates. The Fed was launched in 1913. If they would be able to control interest rates, they wouldn't have gone up from 44% to 15% over a duration of 40 years. They were able to print lots of money then also and bought lots of governments also, yet the market still pushed interest rates up. Because, yeah, as today, for example, how much does the Federal Reserve own in government bonds is only 20% of the total supply in circulation. The other remaining 80% is owned by the market, other players, and it's based on them for the most part whether they decide to buy or sell, whether they are bullish on bonds or bearish. That will decide if interest rates go up or down. And there's very good money to be made, because if interest rates go down, the bonds go up a lot. For example, this year, 2020, interest rate dropped for this 10-year treasury 10-year treasury dropped from 2% to now 1%, yeah, because we went to 0.5%, we're back up to 1%. So 2%, about, so what happened to the bond fund? But, and then I'm talking about TLT, and that's not consistent. It's actually not an average duration of 10 years. This is actually 19 years, almost 20 years. That's the average duration of the bonds that are in the TLT fund. TLT is the iShares 20 plus year treasury bond ETF. So that bond fund went up from 140 to a peak of 170, and it's now back at 155. So what will happen? So what's the potential here? Well, I think in the short term and long term, in the short term, it's likely that, because if you see, let's say that we're not, that we haven't reached the bottom yet, huh? And that even with the US treasuries, we will go to negative interest rates, which is what many people think today. Like, yeah, it's only 2.5%. We can go negative. Look at all the other governments have negative yields in Europe, a lot of them, on these 10-year treasury notes, which is crazy. Can happen in the US also. And so let's say they are right, and we have another couple more years of declining interest rates. Well, then still, actually, it's likely that we'll bounce here, huh? Because as you can see, even during a falling market, you have steep falls, but bounces, steep fall, bounce, steep fall, bounce, steep fall, bounce, steep fall, small bounce, steep fall, bounce, fall, bounce. So now we had a steep fall, we're likely going to get a bounce, huh? We likely will go back up to 2%, even if we're in a long-term rising, falling interest rates, then still it's likely we'll go to 2%. So still it's likely that we're currently at 1%, that will go to 2%. So how much can you make with that if you short the TLT? Well, here you have a nice chart shared by Perk. And if, for example, 10-year bonds go from 1% to 2% in interest rate, then a 10-year bond will lose 20% of its value. Because you bought them and they yield 1%, and then the year later, if you buy a new one, you get 2%. So what's the value of your bond? It's still going to run for 9 years and you only get 1%. Well, it will drop by about 20% in value, your bond. You cannot sell it at the nominal value anymore that you paid. You now paid for 80, you only get 80% of the nominal value if you want to get rid of it. They don't have the 20-year duration here, only the 30 and the 10. For a 30-year, it would be even worse. You lose 40%. So on average, if for a 20-year duration, it would be around 30% here that you lose. But I don't think that's fully accurate. If I do the simulation with the TLT, I get different results. From my calculation, the potential here is indeed that if it goes up, the 10-year goes up from 1 to 2%, then the TLT fund will drop with 15%. But the potential here is that we're not going from 1 to 2%, we go to 3%. Even if we're still in a falling interest rates, I do believe that is the potential here. 3% is this one. Because this is what happened during basically the Corona crisis. It went down a lot. In just, let me show you, Corona crisis. Well, actually, no, it's the last part of 2019, which was just a financial crisis, you could say. No, that was not. No. The Corona crisis only went from 2% to 1%. It depends. If you say the potential is 2%, then it can go up with 15%. So if you short TLT, you likely make a 15% return. And that likely will happen over next year, that we go back to a 2% yield for the 10-year treasury, and the TLT drops then from the current 155, drops back to 140. Yeah, 140. And so you're shorting at 155, and it will go to 140. That's likely. Of course, when shorting bonds, there are some expenses. You have to pay the borrow fee to borrow those shares, those TLT shares, and sell them. You borrow them, in fact, and you have to pay them back later. And that's 0.5% borrow fee per year. And also, you have to pay the dividends if you short, or the interest that they pay out. And this TLT fund pays out 1.6% per year. You also have to pay as a shorter, because when you short, then you borrow the shares, you sell it in the market, and you get the proceeds. But the one that is lending you those shares, he still wants to get his dividend. And so that you need to pay that from your own pocket, even though you don't get them because you sold those shares, you don't get those dividends, but you do have to pay them, and that's 1.6%. So it's about 2% in expenses you have per year. But if you're likely gonna make 15%, then it's a good deal to pay 2% in expenses, huh? And then you still have 13 or 10% left or so. And in the meantime, you can use that money for other investments, and that's where the big gain lays, because yeah, you make 10% on shorting it, but in the meantime, you can use that, and likely during that scenario when interest rates go back to normal, the economy and also goes back to normal, and so certain stocks that have been severely affected by the corona crisis also go back to normal valuations, such as airlines, for example, or cruise lines, or yeah, of course, stock market has boomed already a lot, but there are still opportunities. And if there are no opportunities now, you can wait it out. You'll have that cash, and that cash you have to pay less and less back. So you're building cash, and you can use that cash later if you see opportunities. And it's a way, great way to be leveraged without paying a expensive borrowing or interest rates. When you borrow from your broker, you pay 5% easily. And if you want to use leverage, but here you can just short bonds, and that doesn't cost you any cash. You actually get cash from it, but you also create leverage. Because you're borrowing basically those shares, and the cash you get from it basically is borrowed, huh? So you're also borrowing, but at a much cheaper rate, at only 0.5% instead of 5%. And you can use that money also to invest in other things. So it's a great way to create leverage in your portfolio, thereby make a lot more money, because you're not investing now with 100% of your portfolio, but with, in my case, for example, with my broker, I have 134% exposure versus my total portfolio. But I only hold 55% of my assets with my broker. But yet I have an exposure of 134%. And so I have a leverage of 2.4% with my broker. And that's thanks to shorting bonds, but also shorting gold. Shorting gold, I'm not building a position anymore. I did that, but I went to minus 36%. I did the same there, and I invested those proceeds in investments, and the investments have gone up in the meantime, while my short on gold has gone down a little, but not that much. But that has been my short. Gold used to be 36% exposure, which was pretty high. It's only 27% now, thanks to that effect. And that's great. But I think with shorting bonds, it's becoming really quite urgent actually to do that, because I think we passed the peak, and I think it's time to pile in here. I think it's likely that we will see the interest rates go up fast, like this V-shaped recovery in the stock market and in the economy that we see after this corona crisis is fast. And it's for the quick ones. And I think it's the same with this shirting bonds here. It's for the quick ones. And it's still a great opportunity. I hope I can pile on some more myself. I think the Kelly calculation here, is reasonable. And there is a small chance we haven't seen the bottom, and interest rates go to zero for 10-year treasuries. And in that case, yeah, you lose 25% shorting this TLT fund, and it goes from 150 to 200. Huh? So that's the potential loss. But what are the chances? That's very low, huh? Very low. And especially that it would happen now and immediately. Even if that happens, it's likely that you have a bounce in the meantime. Nothing goes up in a straight line, and also nothing goes down in a straight line. Eh? These charts show that very clearly. Eh? So even if the bottom is here, in the meantime, likely it will shoot back up before it goes down more. Eh? But okay, it could happen today. Also, I have to always take that into account. And what is the potential loss? It's 25%, but the chance is only 20%. Huh? You could say. Or you can even say 10% actually. And in that case, the recommended exposure, so that means that you have a 90% chance to actually make over the next year 12%. That's minus expenses. Huh? I deducted. That's assuming that it will take 2 years to go back to 3% from the current 1%, the 10-year treasury. They will take 2 years to go to 3%, 1 to 3%, and because and then the TLT will drop at 28%, which will be your profit, huh? But over 2 years, so over 1 year, it would be then be only go to 2%, and then that means in 1 year you would make like not the 28%, but 12% after expenses of 2% per year that you so you make 14%, but you have 2% expenses. So you have 12% net. Huh? A 90% chance to make 12% is an expected return of 8% you'll make on the short. And so Kelly recommends a high exposure. And I take not half Kelly, but I take 60% Kelly, a little bit more than half, because yeah, that's what you need to do when you have very great probabilities, like historical. When you have reach historical high or low valuations of something, that's a confidence creator. When you have extreme fear in the market, extreme like Armageddon scenarios, then you need to take full advantage of that, because it's very unlikely it will stay like that. And that's certainly what we saw here in 2020 with this corona crisis. Absolute crazy shit, huh? The world went crazy, huh? And still crazy today, huh? That's a great opportunity, huh? Because it likely will not stay like that, huh? When economies are shut down, and people are locked up in their homes, then it's likely not gonna get much worse than that. If people are, if the world is upside down, huh, when then they can't last. It's not likely to last. It's not likely to get worse. It's likely to get better. Great trade. I think that should be really done here. And that's about the shorting bonds. You see the way it went down. I always have to like it can go back up the same way, and we can actually be only in a month. We could be back at 2%, huh? But at 1%, that could only go be in a month already that we go back to 2%, and then a little correction, and then over the next year we go back to 3%. I think that's actually very likely. I wouldn't say very. Maybe it's going to be a little bit slower, but I do think that it's likely we saw the bottom in interest rates. Yeah. Because we're in a long-term stock bull market, huh? See my other videos about that, but very likely stocks will continue to go up a lot, and that will attract all those bond investors. That will make them dump their bonds that have ridiculous low returns. That will make it them dump it and invest in the stock market. That will drive the stock market more up also, but it also will drive bonds down. I think that's the story on shorting bonds. A great opportunity. Yeah. What made me hesitant to go hard on this position actually before was that the fear. The fear that the markets will correct a lot, and in that case that we make those new highs, new lows in interest rates, and in that case I'll lose a lot on my short-term bonds. But at the same time I lose it while at the same time my other assets correct a lot, and that's what the problem here. What makes me hesitant to pile into those shorting bonds? Let's say we test the corona bottom, and for crypto I am bearish. I think it will correct a lot. But okay, if you look at my broker positions, tankers, they will not correct that much in that scenario. But like my airlines, that just went up a lot, but will go down again a lot. Tech stocks will correct, or not as much. My short gold will have a small profit. But my short bonds, instead of going down, they will go up, and so my pos and due to the rest going down and my bonds going up in up mean is negative for me. My exposure in bonds, even without buying anything, currently is 12%. Even without adding to my position, it would become an exposure of 24%, and and I will get margin calls with my broker, and that's the problem that I see in piling onto shorting bonds right now. It's the most dangerous. It's much more dangerous shorting bonds than shorting gold, for example, because when you have a deflationary collapse, gold will also go down. So when you short gold, you'll actually have a profit position there because gold will likely go down. So in a case of a deflationary collapse, the short on gold will not be causing big problems, but the short on bonds will, because bonds interest rates will collapse, meaning bonds will explode in value, and so you're shorting bonds, and in that case you certainly get a massive loss added to your other losses. Meaning that your own equity goes down a lot in value, causing your leverage to be exceeded, causing margin calls. That's what makes me hesitant to pile into bonds. That's a problem that I need to think more about how to solve that. If anybody knows how I could play this without having that risk, let me know. Thanks for watching.